Hey, it's me, Destin. Welcome back to Smarter Every Day. I'm currently sitting in an airport with my oldest son, and we are on our way to Idaho. Where did Superman get his superpowers?
Krypton.
The planet Krypton. What about Batman? How did he get his superpowers?
He learned his.
Do you think people can learn superpowers?
Yes, sir.
Yeah, me too. Here's the deal. If you could have a superpower for good, what would it be? If you watch Smarter Every Day for any length of time, you know that I would want my superpower to be flight. But not like Superman, I would want to become a pilot. I'm actively working on it, actually. When I was younger, I read this book. It was called Through Gates of Splendor by Elizabeth Elliot. And in the book, I met a guy named Nate Saint. This was the first time I realized you could use your technical abilities to help other people. Whenever there's a natural disaster, like a tsunami or an earthquake, often governments will send aid to these really tiny nations who don't have the infrastructure to get it out to the isolated people that need it. That's where superheroes come in. These guys fly the aid up into the bush and get it to the people who need it. So today on Smarter Every Day, I want to go to the organization that Nate worked for. It's called the Mission Aviation Fellowship, and learn how these guys train to become real-life superheroes. Okay, here we are. We're at MAF headquarters in Nampa, Idaho, and this is Aaron. He let me stay at his house last night, and we're going to meet Brian.
Brian, yep.
All right, cool.
Sure.
Are you Brian? I'm Destin.
Good to meet you.
Nice to meet you. How you doing? Meet Brian Shepson, chief training pilot for the MAF. I figured out pretty quick that Brian's an extremely humble man, despite the fact that he spent over a decade flying in the jungles of Ecuador, which makes him somewhat of a legend. Now he travels all over the world teaching the next generation of pilots and mechanics so they can fly safely in crazy conditions.
So you basically train superheroes, right?
Well, pretty much every day by your definition, yes.
We go places that are hard to get. If roads come in or other transportation systems come in, we leave. We go to another part of the world that's hard to get to.
This airplane is a good combination between being able to carry and being able to get in and out of a short airstrip.
We have heavy-duty gear. The tire is a bigger size. We have gravel guards to keep rocks and things from hitting the tail.
A rubber abrasion boot on the tail to deflect rocks.
Tip extenders on the wings.
A fuel tank for extra range if we need it.
A fuel tank in the tip here?
Yes, an extra 15 gallons on a side.
This cuff here, it adds a little bit more aerodynamic
grip at the slower, higher angles of attack.
We have a mirror over here so that we can see if we have any smoke or fire or oil.
We have a cargo pod underneath.
We can put cargo in the aircraft without having to tie it down. Here we can just open the door and we can slide in stuff.
Pigs and chickens and things that
You're not exaggerating. You ship livestock.
Oh yeah, we carry anything. Crocodiles, snakes, you name it. If it needs to be transported, we can transport it.
Brian agreed to take me up into the mountains to teach me a little bit about flying in rough terrain. We strapped in and headed up to the wilderness of central Idaho, where the first thing he wanted to teach me was how to fly through a valley if you're forced to fly below the mountaintops.
The untrained pilot in terrain would fly right up the middle and go right through the middle of that pass. The trained pilot knows I need to be able to turn out of here.
Yeah, because if you go through the middle and you take a turn left or right,
you have half of the valley to work with.
Right.
So what we do is we work with the whole valley, then we have the whole valley to turn with.
How do you do that?
We move over to one side or the other. Let's go ahead and move over to the right side here. And so the whole idea is, can you see how much room I have over there to turn around in?
That's your out.
That's my out, but I have to be able to turn to get there. Nothing out there?
Clear.
Let's go ahead and turn. We just had about 4 inches of manifold pressure.
You're pulling back to maintain altitude.
45 degrees of bank.
Yep.
Oh, finish the turn.
You didn't even use a third of it.
Think about what Brian is saying here. If you lose an engine, you're going to start to descend. Even though it feels more dangerous because you're so close, hugging the mountain is your clearest bet for survival.
How many people would you say that you have saved over the years from things like disease or, you know, medical extractions, things like that?
Oh my goodness, I don't even know if I could hazard or guess. We actually would do teams that would go in and administer vaccinations for kids. Almost all of the kids in the jungles of Ecuador where I flew, they received their vaccinations because we flew the doctors there.
When you're transporting a vaccine, you have to worry about what's called cold chain management. If a vaccine warms up, it loses its potency. So even if the medicine is in country, you can't get it to the people who need it in time if you have to hike for days across rough terrain and through water. This is why airplanes are like having a superpower. You can get the vaccine to the people who need it in minutes instead of days.
There was a meningitis outbreak in a valley that was completely isolated because of snow on the roads. Couldn't get to it for like 4 months out of the year. And the nurse in the village called, and we were able to package up 300 vials of the treatment, the serum, fly up there and drop those out of the airplane. and only one of the little vials broke out of 300. I think you did a good job of packaging those.
That's amazing. It's like the egg drop competition at school, only
that's right.
That's going to save somebody's
only
life.
Only life and death, that's right.
I can tell you from experience that the hardest part of flying is making a good landing. So I asked Brian to show me an example of the airstrips that jungle pilots might have to land on. These strips are often cut into the jungle with machetes, so they're very short and very narrow. The craziest thing about these runways is that you often have to commit. Either they're so short that you have one chance to take off, or there's a mountain in the way and you can't do a go around if you miss the approach. Once you commit, you either have to do it right or you crash. This is the width of the Atlanta runway, and this is the width of the dirt runway that Brian's about to land on. I looked it up, it's 1/10 as long, and oh by the way, just to make it interesting, it's pointing uphill with a huge bump right in the middle. This means that instead of gently gliding down to the ground, we have to pull up at exactly the right second and start flying uphill, or we're gonna smash and pancake into the dirt. The geometry is such that the hill rises faster than the plane can pull out, so you're committed. You either land or you don't. Usually understanding the physics of what's about to go down makes me calm, but in this case, it made me nervous.
Little sinker, and we're committed. Start our flare. Just touch it, and good hard brakes. And we got stopped by the windsock.
You are a boss.
Yeah, and that just shows what slope can do for us.
That's impressive.
And dirt, you can brake as hard as you want on dirt. You're not gonna hurt anything. On asphalt, you'll slide and flat the tires.
There's no threat of tipping over?
Uh-uh.
It's skills like making these landings every single day which helps the MAF get help exactly where it's needed. The main thing I learned, though, wasn't about the pilots. It's that people who learn these skills can use them to save people in a desperate situation and basically become superheroes. Technicians build the planes, IT professionals, radio operators, logisticians, engineers, medical professionals. Every technical skill becomes a superpower if you choose to use it not to build yourself up, but to help others in their time of need.
For snake bites and venoms, we'd fly live snakes up to a serpentarium where they could do the milking and make a venom that would work specifically for our area.
You would fly snakes in the plane with you?
Snakes on a plane. That's right.
Wait, there's a planet really named Krypton?
No, there's not.